what you really came here to see tonight, which is to hear Wendy and Anna share their stories. Are you guys ready for it? Yes. Sweet. All right. Wendy and Anna.
Sorry, I need my actual microphone. Well, thank you so much, Melanie. And I'll just begin by saying my name is Wendy Lyons Crosstech, and I'm the Leawood location pastor here. And I want to thank those of you who are with us in person, as well as those of you who are joining us online. I am absolutely honored to be able to be sharing the stage with such an incredible young woman. And I know that you will be inspired by her as well. And as we are gathering together, I know you guys are, folks are coming in. Feel free to come on in, find a seat, sit together, make new friends. I'm happy to have you. There's plenty of space. But I'm going to open us up in a word of prayer so that we can center our hearts for connection. So let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the ways that you speak through others. And we pray that our hearts might be open today, that as we share in conversation and connection with those at our tables, as we hear Anna today inspire us and challenge us, and we feel the work of the Holy Spirit today, may we leave different than we walked in, that we might leave different than those who came into this space, and that we might find hope and strength and an excitement for how we might live our lives differently. So we offer this time to you, and we give you thanks. In Christ's name, amen. All right. Well, I'm going to turn it over. This is Anna Sarol, and we're delighted to have so many of you joining us here today. And I just want to say thank you for being with us today. And so Anna is a longtime member of our church, and so I thought I would just begin by asking the very first question, and that is, how long have you been coming to Resurrection, and what's your connection here, and how are you involved?
Yeah. So first of all, hi everyone. My name is Anna. I'm super excited to have this conversation with you all, and I hope that you guys gain so much out of this and for the time that we have. As far as what my like faith journey has looked like, I can give you guys a little bit summary of like what I've done. But both of my parents were both born in the Philippines, and in the Philippines, the predominant religion is actually Catholicism. So they regularly practiced that, and then when they gave birth to me and my siblings, they knew they wanted to pass that tradition along. Most of my childhood, along with my siblings, has been practicing Catholic practices. And so it wasn't even until when my oldest sister entered college, she went to MNU, and she did some exploration with Christianity, and she actually found CORE. And I just can recall the moments when she would just come back so enlightened and so fulfilled from services here. And she actually talked to my parents, and she was like, I would love for you all to join me to worship and come and see what exactly I'm talking about, what I'm seeing in this church. And so she invited us to come here. And when we did, it was roughly around like 8 years ago. And then ever since that Sunday that we came and we saw this beautiful church, that's when we started calling this place home.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Anna. And as you think about how your faith has formed you, what do you find for your own life right now? How are you living out your faith right now?
Yeah, so, and this kind of ties in with my involvement with the church. So this year, I actually joined church council, and that's been very insightful, and I'm so glad that we have someone who's disabled and allowing that voice, to, like a seat at the table, because that's something that we, as disabled people, voice a lot, that we feel like sometimes what we're saying is pushed under the rug and aren't always accounted for and prioritized. And so my faith has brought me and completed me in the most amazing way.
Awesome. Thank you, Anna. Well, I wanted to give you an opportunity and hope that you would share a bit of your story. So I'm going to leave it just sort of open-ended in that way so that you can share what you feel comfortable with. But I know that this community of people want to hear from you.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So I was born and raised in Olathe, Kansas, so my entire life has been here. I have three sisters and one brother and two amazing parents. And my three sisters, they actually grew up being gymnasts. So my parents, they wanted all of their kids to be active, and the way that they did that was putting us into sports. And I think that's, I'm such a sports lover that I will always say that parents should always push their children to like try different things when it comes to sports. But again, my three sisters, they were all gymnasts, and so naturally my parents wanted to put me into the sport of gymnastics. And so I started recreational gymnastics at the age of 5. And then I kind of started competitive gymnastics a little bit later than like the average person who starts competitive gymnastics. So roughly around like 8 or 9. But the thing was that like I was able to pick up skills pretty easily. So I was able to advance pretty quickly, I would say, for the age that I was in. And I competed gymnastics for like almost 8 years. And then I entered the high school level, and I decided that just like any other teenager, I wanted to represent my school, and by doing so, I wanted to be a student athlete. So I decided to join their gymnastics program at Olathe Northwest, which is the school that I went to. And about 4 days into practices, which was like my fourth day of high school ever, and this was my fourth practice, it was just a typical day. I went into practice just like any other practice, and we had one first event. So my first event was floor. I was warming up and everything, and then we rotated events, and I went to the uneven bars. Now for the uneven bars, we have grips. And so I put my grips on, I got my chalk on, and I did a simple warm-up that I could probably do in my sleep. Like it was a simple warm-up that I've been practicing and warming up with for the past 8 years. So nothing untypical. So, and then I did my normal skills on the low bar because, as I said, I was warming up for the bigger skills. And then I jumped to the high bar, and I did my typical skills that I perform in the high bar. And then I can recall that day that it felt like time was slowing down. When I say that I had like an out-of-body experience, like I definitely had that and experienced that, and it was very crazy to look back on. But as I was preparing for the dismount, I was doing my typical swings, and I noticed that I had a lot more power than usual. And then seconds later, my hands peeled off the bar, and I landed on my back, instantly paralyzing me. Now, again, listening to my story, I know that sometimes parents can form these ideas that this is why I don't put my child into sports, or this is why I don't put them into gymnastics specifically, because we all know that we have risks in life. That's everything that comes in life. And so when I share my story, I always want to give that little disclaimer that I'm actually coaching the sport of gymnastics right now. And so I come back and I go back to the environment that in which I was injured, and I am coaching the next generation of gymnasts so that I can pass down my knowledge and help them to be the best that they can be, the best athlete that they can be. So going back to my story, when it all happened, I didn't understand what exactly was happening to my body. I just knew that I fell. I lost consciousness for a couple of seconds, because the second that I woke up, I just can recall all my coaches and teammates surrounding me, no one having the answers, and I just couldn't feel my legs, or I couldn't have any kind of sensation. Now, my mom, she's a nurse practitioner, so you can like hear her through the phone of her concerns, because she knew what exactly happened before anyone did, before the ambulance came, before anyone. So when the ambulance came, they put me on a stretcher, and again, I'd had no answers on what exactly happened to me. All I knew was that I fell, and the athlete in me was like, why don't you just get up, like, walk it off, let's go. But I was taken to Overland Park Regionals to take some tests, do some CAT scans, get some answers. And then they decided that they have to life fly me to Children's Mercy downtown because I need to be prepared for my surgery the following day of my injury. So I went to Children's Mercy. The next day I went to surgery. The surgery was about 8 hours. They fused my spine at T10. That is where my injury is. So for those of you who don't know anatomy, the anatomy of the body, it's right where your belly button is. So right below that is where I have lost sensation and function. And then, yeah, that's kind of like what my story, what the beginning of my story was. And skip forwarding to now, like I am now a disabled model, a disability advocate. I am an adaptive athlete. I do CrossFit now. And I am a full-time college student. So that's kind of just the gist. And I know we can explore some more, but I'm sure that there's questions that you have.
Great. Thank you so much, Anna. And I was, you know, as a pastor, I connect with and have an opportunity to hear people's stories. And one of the things I was just thinking as you were sharing, I'm wondering for you, is it hard to share and to relive some of that? Or does it feel like you feel healing when you have an opportunity to share it? Or how does it strike you? Or is it different times?
Yeah. I believe that because I'm in such a healthy and good mental state that I'm able to reshare what exactly happened to me on that day. Mm-hmm. And I know that this isn't something everyone experiences, so you definitely have to be aware of that, because sometimes when you ask the question of, like, what happened to you, it can cause that person to revisit that time of trauma, which can be... sometimes if you're not in the mental capacity, then yeah.
So it can be triggering, right?
It can, mm-hmm. Yes. But yeah, so that's kind of why I wanted to share my story, so that I can give and empower people like my story, and then also just share to the general society, like, what exactly happened to me and how I am living towards a... Yeah. Really good future.
It's awesome. Thank you, Anna. As you think about the people that, I remember you talking about Pastor Steve came to visit you. Were there other people who showed up for you in your life, maybe that were unexpected, or people that were really inspiring and helpful to you during that time?
Yeah, so I had an experience so much community love from everyone, and it was almost overwhelming. And I know my parents would say the same. And it's been crazy because a lot of people stepped up and they helped us create an accessible room in my house, because all the rooms were accessed on the second floor. So when I came home after the hospital, I had no place to go other than just being in the main floor. And so a lot of people stepped up and were like, can we mow the lawn for you while you're in the hospital? Can we bring you food? Can we help out in any other way? And they did exactly that.
That's incredible. Amazing. I know, you know, when you think about what it means to have people show up for other people, like just showing up and doing things where, and I know that maybe some of you might have been here last week and Mindy Corporan was talking, and even thinking about the idea, instead of saying, what can I do, just doing something, you know, and saying, just saying, I'm going to do this, so that instead of giving something for someone to do, that you would allow them just to do whatever they can to offer care and support. So after your accident, how did you find, tell me a little bit about your faith experience, and how did it grow, or was it challenged?
Yeah. Okay. So when it came down to listening to the diagnosis of what had happened to me, it was pretty difficult to hear, you know, and I know a lot of people with spinal cord injuries would say that a lot of what they heard from the doctors was that they weren't going to be able to walk again, they won't be able to use their legs, but I kind of turned those statements around, and I am using, like, my paralyzed legs to empower a lot of people. And I know that a lot of people are like, you're not going to ever use them, but this has given me the kind of purpose that I needed in life. When I first started coming to CORE, I can remember when Pastor Adam would always talk about how, and he still to this day talks about how every morning he goes down on his knees and he says, God, I am yours and I am all of yours. Do what you need from me so that I can be of service to your people. And I can recall a time where I prayed that every single day. And during that time, which is kind of crazy that I tell this to Pastor Adam too, when I prayed that every day, it's kind of crazy with the timeline, but a month later is my injury, what happened, and I fell on a skill that I had never fallen before. And I also have never had like a broken bone before this injury. I've never sprained an, actually I've sprained an ankle. But I haven't done any of those things. And so it's kind of crazy to think that like now I'm paralyzed. And when I prayed that, I didn't understand that that was God's calling for me. So it's kind of crazy to think about. And I still, to this day, I reflect on that because it's guided my faith. And during the times where this has been difficult and during those specific low points, I looked to this and I'm like, recalling back those times where I prayed for my calling and my purpose and to find that. And I think this is it.
Beautiful. Thank you, Anna. Well, every time that I'm in your presence, I'm sure that others in this room can feel that as well. Your vulnerability and your honesty and the way in which you are just pouring yourself out is such an incredible gift. And as you and I were talking, one of the things that I know you're really extremely passionate about is, you know, your calling is to be able to help people in advocacy. And so how do we as people become allies and then transition from what does it mean to be an ally to be being an advocate? So could you share with us more about what we can do?
Yeah. Okay. So it's kind of, I think I'm going to start with like differentiating the two. So an ally and advocate, both of them support the marginalized voice and the marginalized group. What kind of differentiates the two is the extent of what they'll do for the group. And so to be an advocate is to amplify our voices. And by doing so, we're talking about and addressing for the disabled community accessibility issues. We're talking about everything that comes and involves that, whether it's like the ADA or the barriers that are put in place for us that might not be seen by society. And so one thing that I wanted to communicate tonight was talking about why it is important for someone to become an advocate and to, especially a disabled advocate, is because people within this community, disabled individuals, take up 15% of the world's population. And that is 1 billion people who have a disability. So we're not just, even though people's disability is not visible and it may not be physical, there are so many different forms of disability. And so there's no cookie cutter of disability and what it should look like and what we think it's going to look like. And then another point that I wanted to bring up was that if we live long enough, eventually we will become disabled. And just think about that. Resonate with that. Our bones will deteriorate. Our muscles will grow weaker. If we live long enough, we're going to need these access needs when it comes to a ramp, when it comes to an accessible stall, accessible parking. We all need this, and this is why it's so important, is because this is the largest minority group, and it's only growing. And it is one of the only groups that you can become and join membership of at any given moment. Like, I was a healthy 14-year-old athlete. I didn't know that this was going to happen to me. I didn't know that I was going to be paralyzed and that I was going to be affected and that the ADA would be the one thing that would give me independence. So it's important, and I would call on everyone to do the research and get involved in some aspect to become advocates.
Thank you. One of the, as you were talking about advocacy and thinking about things that are helpful for us to do and then helpful things for us not to do, so do's and don'ts, and would you be willing to share with us what some of those things would be so that as we're saying we want to become advocates that you can speak directly to us so that we know how best to be an advocate?
Yeah, so I love this question so much that I wrote a list so that I made sure that I didn't forget anything. So we can start with, like, so this is essentially addressing disability etiquette. And so there's the do's and don'ts. So I'm going to go ahead and start with the don'ts. And I want you all, if you're taking notes, to please write these down. Or if you're making mental notes, then I would invite you to do so too. So the don't. One of the first don'ts. Don't use accessible amenities if you don't need them. So this looks like people abusing accessible parking spots. This is huge. This is so huge. I have an accessible van that deploys a ramp, and a lot of people, I wouldn't say a lot of people, some people with wheelchairs need this vehicle to get in and out. And so those striped lines that you see next to the accessible parking spots are called access aisles. This is how we can deploy that ramp so that we can get in and out of our car independently. Now, I feel like a lot of people know that you're not supposed to park there unless you have the permit, right? But we have all seen this common theme of people saying, well, I'm gonna just park here really fast and run in and grab my Chipotle and then come back. And we're like, it doesn't work like that. Like, this isn't a place where you can just leave your car on, grab something and go. And although I know that it's a quick process, it's not. You're stripping away our independence by parking there, even if it's for 5 minutes, even for 5 seconds. I dealt with this today, and I deal with it every single day. But, like, for example, I went to Starbucks this morning, and I was getting in my car, and then I saw a person park in the access aisle in the dashed lines. And they saw my sign on the side of my vehicle that says, please do not park within 8 feet next to this car, because that's the side that my ramp comes out, right? And they saw the sign and they moved to the actual parking spot. And I could tell that they did a to-go order, and I don't want to ever make assumptions because, again, not everyone's disability is visible, so making that assumption that they're not disabled and that they don't need it is harmful, so I do want to say that. But they didn't have the placard, and they didn't have the symbol on the license plate. And so, therefore, I was supposed to be leaving, but I decided to stay. And I decided to let out my ramp and just wait out by my ramp until they came back. And so when they came back, they saw me, and being the advocate that I am, I wanted to not necessarily call them out for it, but call them in. And I wanted to inform them, you know, like, this is what's giving me independence. This is what's allowing me to go in my environment, be by myself, and live a normal life. And by you taking that away from someone is everything to them. I mean, like, I have a cone in the back of my car just in case I don't find enough accessible parking wherever I go, so that I can park in the very back of the parking lot to make sure that I have two spots right next to me that are going to be free, and then I put my cone down. But it's not even that I can't roll the extra distance. It's the fact of, like, I need the space right next to me. And I need it, and I need it to be free. I need it to be there. There's people who are on motorcycles who will park there. And there's shopping carts. Let me address that, too. Oh, my gosh. Grocery stores, too. And you guys are not going to, you're not going to be able to unsee this when you go to grocery stores. Like, next time you go to the grocery store, look at the accessible parking. You're gonna see grocery carts everywhere. You're gonna see, especially in the access aisles, everywhere. And this was something, even when I was walking, I would just be like, well, I don't really want to walk it all the way to where they put them, so I'm just going to put it right here. It's on the grass. It's fine. They can move it if they need to move it. No, like, this is also a barrier for us to be able to get in our car. That was a long story. And then let me move on to the accessible amenity of restrooms and accessible stalls. So I know that a lot of people tend to first go to the accessible stall if it's the first one open and there's like all these stalls, okay? The issue that I have with this is that, again, this is the only stall that I can access. This is the only stall I can go in. This is the one that I can fit through. And again, it's the only one that I have. So if people are in there and that's the first one that they go to when all the other stalls are open, I have to wait for that person, for them to come out, and then I go to the restroom. But think about how long that could be. We don't know how long people are in the bathroom for. So if you can, like, please, please, please just use the regular stalls, because I cannot wait for you. Yes. Okay, moving on to my next don't. Please don't make assumptions about our limitations and our abilities. Now, when I say this, I mean things like unsolicited help and helping without asking first is something that we experience a lot. So, as someone who has full function and mobility of my arms, I like to do things as much as I can independently. And that's like one thing that I feel like a lot of disabled people want to keep, is that they want to be as independent as they can. And so that's a huge one. My next don't is leading the conversation with, what happened to you? So this question, I've been asked this question more times than I can count before the question, how are you? Or what's your name? It's like, what happened to you? Why are you in a wheelchair? Which I understand. A lot of people's curiosity tends to peek out. And I, just like I'm standing in front of the stage, like, I am the most transparent and open person, so I love having these conversations. But when it's the first thing that someone asks, it's like there's so much more to me than just like what happened to me, and making that assumption that something happened to me, because there's things like transverse myelitis, which it can be. It doesn't necessarily have to be a spinal cord injury or something traumatic happening to me to get me into this position. So could you imagine being born with a mobility disability and constantly being asked this question throughout your life? Like, think about it. What happened to you? Yeah, so, and then my next don't, my final don't, is don't shush a child for their curiosity. This is very big. I've talked to this a lot with a lot of people. Children tend to be the most curious people ever, and they ask the most curious questions. By telling a child, hey, don't say that, or like, don't ask about their wheelchair, don't ask about their disability. Children, they have different, we have different expectations for what they'll ask. So by telling them to be quiet and to like kind of dismiss our disability is not inviting them to ask the questions and to gain the information. And I think that by shushing a child, they'll start to transform to an adult, and they'll start to, this also like will just be a ripple effect of like them being an adult and ignoring disability and ignoring our barriers and everything that goes along with disability. So start the conversation, like have them, if they're so curious to ask a question, why don't you invite them and be like, hey, why don't you go ahead and ask them? Maybe they'll answer. And if they don't, then they don't want to answer. But if they do, then maybe it can be very insightful. Next, we're going to move on to do's. So... Yes, do's. Do hire disabled individuals. This is huge. A lot of people, I feel like, have to almost put so much more effort into trying to find a job and an employment to try to, like, convince the interviewee that they're fully capable of what they say they'll do and what they'll bring for the company. But this also addresses the fact of, like, making your business, making your company more diverse and making them so that they can have a variety of perspectives, right? And I want to bring up an interesting fact, actually. So there's this, I can't recall the exact act name, but there's an act that still allows people with disabilities to be paid subminimal wages. Some people are paid below minimum wage just because they have a disability. And I bring this up because I want you guys to search about this. No more information. I'm not going to give you all the answers because I want you to do the work and have this curiosity generated so that you can take it to the computer and do the research. Why is that the way that it is? What does this mean? So my next do is please make eye contact with us and make direct communication. I can't tell you the number of times where I felt secluded from a conversation because people don't make eye contact to me because I'm in a different playing field, whether they're standing. And there's been times where even people will talk to my mother and be like, "What?" Or like a waitress, for example, will be like, "What does she want?" Like, and then my mom will just stay silent. She won't even say anything. She'll just wait until like I say something so that I can speak for myself. So please make direct conversation with us. We want to be included. We want to be seen as whole, and we want to be part of the conversation. And it's very important. My last do is do advocate for and with us. We need your voices. We need you. We need you in this world. We live in a very inaccessible world, and there's a lot of things that I'm probably not going to mention tonight because we don't have 20 hours, but there's so much that goes into living a disabled lifestyle. There's so much barriers that I'm not going to be able to address because we would be here for hours, and there's so much that we can do better. We want to build an inclusive world, right? Because a lot of people are going to be affected.
Thank you, Anna. Well, I was taking notes, and I hope that you were as well. And we wanted to allow some conversation for you all at the tables, but I think you had a, did you want to show the video before?
Yes.
Oh, before we, I know we were jumping it. I was asking you lots of questions. So we will have an opportunity for discussion and conversation, but Lane, would you bring up the video for
can
us?
Can I say something really fast?
Yeah.
Before the video, sorry about that. I didn't tell her that, so that's why. So every year that my injury comes around, I decide to do a video talking and addressing certain things. So the video that we're about to see is called entitled Dear Me. And it was, I think, my fourth anniversary is when I produced it and published it. But it just talks about like everything that I experienced for the past 4 years, but also just the strong and resilient person that I am today. So I hope you enjoy.
Dear me, on August 20th, 2015. You're scared. I know. You were just told that you're never going to be able to walk again. That you'll be in a wheelchair for the rest of your life. You're thinking, how will people look at me now that I'm in a wheelchair? What does it mean to be paralyzed? How will I get through this? For the next month, you're going to be bedridden. Your back is going to hurt, and it'll be sensitive there for quite a while. The month after that, you'll have to leave your family and travel to Chicago for some advanced rehab. You're going to have to learn how to bathe again, how to get in bed again, how to retain your balance again. You're going to have to learn how to live life again. and there will be things that you've never experienced before. People will stare at the wheelchair, and that's okay, because you'll show them that wheelchair users can be independent too. You'll learn how heavy a door is to pull open without the use of your legs, but you'll become so strong that soon enough, you'll be able to do it all by yourself. You'll realize that the slightest incline will be physically and mentally challenging, but your arms are your legs now. You are going to build so much muscle in them and be able to do more than you ever thought was possible. In a couple of years, you will learn how to drive a car using hand controls, and you will get a car of your very own. This will help you get back on your feet and take back your independence. You're going to acquire a job with elementary school students. You will teach them about diversity and inclusion in hopes that they will grow up to be more aware of people with disabilities. You're going to travel across the globe to a third world country and provide aid for those in need. This will show the world that even if you aren't able to walk, you're not going to make any excuses. You'll keep a promise of walking across the stage to receive your high school diploma on graduation day. And nothing is going to compare with the feeling of looking up and seeing that standing ovation. I'm not going to tell you that it'll be easy, because it won't. But I'm writing to you now, telling you that your strength through this pain is all worth it. And more importantly, you're going to understand that your life has changed for the better. Every year this day comes around, you'll get stronger and stronger. If only you could hear all of the people who have told you that you have changed their lives and perspective of this world. I'm here now, 4 years later, telling you that even if I had one wish that could be granted today, I wouldn't change what happened. You don't know yet, but this setback in life is going to take you farther than your able legs ever could have. You're scared. I know. But just wait. I am going to make you so proud.
Wow. Thank you. Well, we have a few questions that we're going to bring up, and I know that you may even just, there are some questions there, but you might just respond and say, what touched you? You might, there might be something else that came up within your list of do's or the do's or don'ts, but want to encourage you to share in conversation at your tables, and we'll give you guys about 10 minutes and then we'll gather you back together.
Thank you. feel the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body.
All right. Well, I was enjoying some conversation and connection up here, as I know and I hear all of you and those of you who are worshiping and joining us online, rather. I'm really grateful for that. We have a few more questions that I wanted to be able to ask Anna, and then if we have time for you to get a chance to do that as well, because you may have some things you wanted to ask her. So I'll ask this question. What lights you up and inspires you?
Oh my gosh, I love this question because of like my answer. I am inspired deeply by the disabled community. They are quite literally experts at adapting things to their lifestyle. And there's people who are super successful with what they do. One of the people that I'm close friends with, her name is Chelsea Hill. She is a dancer. She founded the Rolettes, which is a all wheelchair user dance team. And they perform all across the country. They're someone to definitely look up on social media if you are on social media. They're doing amazing things. There's roughly, I think, close to like eight wheelchair users who are on the team. And she inspires me. Who else? There's so many people. I can't recall his last name, but his name's Aaron. Aaron Wheels, I believe. But he's pretty amazing. So he does a bunch of like wheelchair tricks with his chair, and he goes down ramps and everything. And I forgot what the terminology is called when they're doing like the skateboard and stuff like that, but in a wheelchair. I forgot, but definitely look up him. There's so many people within this community who are literally just coming up with ways on how they can be successful in life. And this might look different for a lot of people with what we define as success. It doesn't necessarily mean the people who have the most money or the people who have high statuses, but just the people who are just going out and every day informing and educating the country and everyone. So they're a huge inspiration to me. And so, yeah. Awesome.
Thanks, Anna. And I follow, if you don't follow Anna on social media, you should follow her and find her on Instagram. And I asked her to share because she has some really incredible videos that she's posting. So tell us about how you're using your social media platform.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, I started to dedicate a lot of my time and investing my time into social media and building an online presence. So I'm mainly found on Instagram and Facebook, and you could look it up later. I could also, I don't know if we can write down little notes of like my handles and everything, but it's just my name, Anna Sarol. And so ever since COVID happened, I've been able to have a lot more time to put into content creating, editing, writing up captions, and blogging my entire life. And essentially the purpose of my social media presence was to really normalize disability and show people just a little insight of disability lifestyle. So I was trying to, when I made this account, I was trying to attract two different audiences. The audience that's everyday people, everyday abled bodies who don't understand or who don't know what disability lifestyle looks like and just wanted a little avenue to educate and inform themselves. And then also provide resource for the people who are disabled and to give them tips and tricks that I have up my sleeve to share with them. So that's been a big thing that I've been doing with my life right now. So what Pastor Wendy was talking about was I do a lot of videos, especially talking about like things like how I put pants on as a wheelchair user, how I transfer in and out from the floor to my wheelchair, just a lot of little how-tos, but also like addressing how I move and how, though my disability is what it is, I still navigate and find a way for myself. And so a lot of that content has been used to start a conversation where disability is focused and talked about, because we definitely need this conversation to be started within our groups, within our friend groups, our family, our communities, our schools. There's definitely a lot of voices that we have.
Awesome. Well, I know that we're getting closer to time, but I'll ask you this last question. What's next? What's your dream and your vision for what comes next for you?
Yes. Oh my gosh, this question is amazing. So I am a full-time college student. So I'm right now pursuing a psychology degree at Kansas University. And with that avenue, I've kind of thought about going into developmental psychology and working with children. And also just, I love advocating for mental health as well. So that's something that's huge for me and for this whole world. Like, we've all went through COVID and we all saw some of our mental health just decline. So I'm working towards that and potentially getting my PhD with that. And then also the fact of like the opportunities that I've gotten with social media has been incredible. Like, when I started this account, I didn't know that I was actually investing my time. I've had opportunities to a business just sent me to Miami to participate in Miami Swim Week to be one of their inclusive models, which was a paid gig, which was amazing because I was like, I would love to travel the world and you send me and just me just look who I am and everything. So that was pretty amazing to see. And then also just becoming an advocate into businesses, you know, doing talks with them and getting them more informed about how I can make their space more inclusive and accessible. Little things like barriers that they don't really notice and see. And then also just, I don't know. You know, the fact that my life can go in so many different directions, I'm so open-minded, and I'm very excited for the future.
Awesome. Thank you, Anna. Well, it is 7:34, and we have a video that we're going to use to close this out. We're not going to do it quite yet, Lane, but I was wondering, is there anyone who has any questions? And Melanie, I don't know if you're out there and you can help me with a microphone, but I got a chance to really just come up with some great questions, and some of you might have them as well. So we have at least one question here. We probably have time for maybe two or three questions. So first question.
I'm Betty, and this is Mom. This is Loisy's mom.
I mean, that's my mom.
Mom, Loisy. And I have known her for a very long time. We worked together for many years, and I remember her telling me early on when the accident happened. She said she was laying in bed one night, and she was just crying and sobbing and saying, you know, what's going to happen, what's going to become of Anna. And she turned around and Anna was coming in the bedroom in her wheelchair. And she said, it's going to be all right, Mom.
Aw, thank you. I love that.
Anna, thanks for being here. I really enjoyed your story. One thing that I wasn't sure that I understood, when you talked about the incident and you said that it was kind of like an out-of-body experience, was that, do you feel that, I didn't understand if that preceded what happened, and I was thinking, you know, this summer about the twisties and Simone Biles and all that thing.
Yes.
Is it something along those lines? You're talking about mental health here and stuff like that, so I don't know if that played a role, or I wasn't sure I understood what you were saying there.
Yeah. So, and I didn't really elaborate as much because I wanted to make sure that I got to everything. But so I was actually telling Pastor Wendy when you guys were all talking in your circles. So when I peeled off the bars and when I told you guys that it felt like time was slowing down, I felt like I had an outer body experience where I transferred to another gymnast and watched myself fall, which was crazy to see. And like, in retrospect, like thinking about it, it was that, like, this movie experience. Like, everything that you see in the movies, I swear, it happened to me. It felt very real. And then I also was mentioning how when they put me on a stretcher, the ambulance, when they got there, there was this narrow hallway that they had to go through to take me to the ambulance. And there was this basketball player who was there at the time. And the medics, they were all like, move out of the way, everyone move, move. And it was just this one guy, it was this one basketball player that just so happened to be there at the time. And I remember rolling past him on the stretcher, laying down there, and he made eye contact with me, and I felt like I transferred to him looking down at me and seeing this little girl who's on the stretcher looking all confused and scared, not knowing what had just happened to her. And it's something that I like telling because it's just that whole experience was very, very different. And it was something that very interesting to think about and think about how we mentally process things.
Thank you.
I know there's a lot of curiosity, so please.
Yeah.
Just like I was, so I'm also a substitute teacher, so you can only imagine the questions I get asked. So please, I'm an open book. So I think we have one here. Yeah, oh my gosh.
Would you restate the question, just because for those who are online might not have been able to hear you, Bill. So greatest hits, things that you've done that you're like, hey, I did that. That's awesome.
I got it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. One that comes in mind is when I go to the grocery store. I swear everything that I want when I go to the grocery store is on the top rack. Everyone knows, see? You all see it, and you're not in wheelchairs. So like I'll become innovative and I'll grab something long and I'll like try to hit it. Try to like catch it when it falls. I'm not afraid to ask for help, but there are times, again, that I want to be independent and I want to be able to go to the grocery store and be able to handle things myself. And then let me think of other things. We went to the Philippines, and I know you guys saw it on my video, but again, this is a third world country. The infrastructure is not the greatest because it is a third world country. And there were so many different barriers that were in the way when it came to accessing the streets and everything. And this kind of ties into like why people with disabilities sometimes feel social exclusion is because when they're placed with something in front of them that they can't go past, like independently, it can be very frustrating and it can cause them to almost like retreat back to their homes, which again, this is why we need advocates. But that whole experience was very eye-opening because I came back to the States realizing that I have access to elevators, to ramps, to curb cutouts, to all of these things that I took for granted and didn't realize that another country across the globe was experiencing something that they didn't even have, which caused them to have social exclusion. So when I reflect on that now, like, my parents are both from the Philippines, so if I were to have been born in the Philippines and had a spinal cord injury or had some kind of disability that required me to have a mobility aid, I wouldn't be able to. I don't know if I would go out. I'd be kind of quite literally stuck in the same four walls. Something to think about.
Anna, I just want to let you know, I've been through cancer, I've been through a lot in my life, and I'm very glad to see there's people like you out there to say that you wouldn't change a thing. I wouldn't have changed a thing either. I feel I've become stronger with it, and I'm just glad to see there's people like out there like you. Thank you.
Thank you for your kind words.
Thank you. Well, it is 7:41, and we wanted to close out with a video, and I know some of you may have children that you have to pick up, so I'm going to ask Lane to bring up the video to close us out. Never mind. Just kidding.
Sorry, Anna. I have one last thing that
totally,
I want to say.
Totally.
I came up on the stage, and it's very hard to be vulnerable. It's very, very, very hard to be vulnerable, but I recognize the privilege that I have, the time and attention that you all are giving me to highlight and amplify these voices, because they're voices that are often silenced. they're often quieted because people try to not include them. And one of the reasons why I am up here is because I want them to be seen. And I want them to know that there's people like them who's able to come in these positions and show the audience that we are more than just a disability. That we need to fight against prejudice, discrimination, ableism, so that we can build this inclusive world. And I've said this a million times, but I need you guys to help me. To help me bring this purpose into life and bring it to the world. Thank you all for letting me have this time and for letting our voices be heard.
Thank you.
Adversity is defined as a noun, meaning difficulties or misfortune. There are times in our lives where we hit disequilibrium. We are thrown out of balance and are given two choices, to either feed into the decision that we are no longer enough, or to fight beyond our corner of comfort and to persevere. But sometimes it's not as easy as picking medicine over poison, and it can be a lonely period. So to the person going through fearful change and feeling that they've lost their direction, this letter is for you. There's nothing more important that I want to do with my time right now than to remind you of how significant and valuable you are. I want you to ask yourself, am I living up to my full potential despite my current limitations? You see, for some reason, we tend to forget our value when we're faced with challenges. It occupies our minds in ways that distract us. When I was hit with the biggest challenge in my life, I struggled to maintain self-love. It was easy to develop the mindset of needing to get back onto my own two feet without this heavy piece of metal following me around, constantly reminding me of my disability. We do this thing called social comparison, where we focus on how we measure up to other people. It's no wonder that those facing adversity can begin to feel like they are incapable and not enough. I often wish I can go back to being able to just like everyone else. I knew the importance of self-love, and I recognized that I wasn't 100% there yet. Scrolling down on my personal Instagram feed around the time I was injured, it was impossible to find a photo of me in my wheelchair. I would transfer to another seat or surface and push my chair out of frame. I didn't want it to be visible, and quite truthfully, my younger self was scared of judgment. When I got hurt, it wasn't the diagnosis or even the severed nerves that held me back. It was the fear of prejudice that paralyzed me. But let me emphasize that you are more than just your physical appearance and abilities. I made the decision to shift my focus, accept myself wholly, and to be proud of the person I have become. Now, all you can find are photos of me proudly displaying my disability, because at the end of the day, I love my chair. But even more, the woman who is sitting in it. There's so much power when you learn to love yourself fully. To love yourself when you're excelling, thriving, and successful, yet also when you're tired, discouraged, or broken. It's a natural human tendency to think otherwise, but I'm here to encourage you to change this perception of yourself for your own well-being. Challenges are a part of the contract of life. You can't leave this world better than you found it without difficulty or discomfort. People grow, people change, people adapt. You are allowed to be that person. Let me be an example of just how amazing it is to unquestionably live your life apart from other people's opinions.
When we face adversity, sometimes the only thing we gravitate towards is going back to equilibrium. But think about the potential you can give to the world now that you have overcome the most significant of challenges. This applies to whatever adversity looks like in your life. I want you to take the lessons from this note beyond the time that it takes for you to read it. This letter is simply a collection of words unless you attach meaning to them. Accompany them with action. Make change today. Show up for yourself. Acknowledge that you are simply going through a trial and persevere. Am I living up to my full potential despite my current limitations? Ask yourself this question every day and watch. It will change your life.
Thank you, guys. Oh my gosh. I hope that you guys took a lot from this and that you will continue to get the conversation going. Yes.
Thank you, Anna. And I know I speak on behalf of those who are in this room and those online who just want to express our gratitude for your story and for your inspiration and your vulnerability and the incredible way that you are touching the lives of so many. So thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.